Welcome, everyone. My name is Bob Lawrence. I am the former director of the Center for a Livable Future and the current acting director. My good friend Jim Yeager has graciously allowed me to have this part of the podium today. On behalf of the center, we are celebrating our 20th anniversary. This is the 17th annual Dodge Lectureship, and the Center and the Department of Environmental Health and Engineering welcome all of you to this very special event. I'm going to leave the introduction to our distinguished visitor, to Bob Martin, who directs our health systems, food systems policy program in the center, and just briefly say a word about the Edward and Nancy Dodge Lectureship. Very early in the center's life, I think we were only about 2 years into our work, we're still encountering a fair amount of skepticism about whether an urban private university with a school of public health had anything to say about the food system. None of us were agronomists or plant scientists or animal husbandry people. And Ed Dodge, MPH graduate of the school from 1967, saw and shared the vision. And out of the blue, we had a generous gift from the Dodge Family Foundation that has endowed this annual lectureship. We have brought to the school a series of very distinguished people over the years, a number of whom, as Tanya Berry just shared with me, we looked through the list of 17, and she and Wendell know over two-thirds of them, and are particularly close to Fred Kirschenman, Vandana Shiva, Patrick Holden, Wes Jackson, and Ricardo Salvador. So it's very fitting that the jewel in our crown of distinguished visitors to deliver the Dodge Lectureship should be Wendell Berry. Before I introduce Bob Martin, I just want to have Ed Dodge and his son Randall, who are with us today. Randall from Indiana, Ed from Texas. Would you please stand and just bow? Thank you. It really has meant so much to me personally, Ed, over the years, for your early commitment, your early wager that this center was going to make an important contribution. So Bob, will you please do the honors now?
Thank you very much, Bob. I welcome everybody in the audience and those viewing at home as well. Since this event is being broadcast, streamed, and it's being recorded, please silence your cell phones if you haven't already done so. I would like to acknowledge Tanya Berry, Wendell's spouse of almost 60 years. She's traveled here with him for the day's activities, a couple days' activities, and it's been wonderful to get to know her as well as Wendell. And I'd also like to acknowledge their daughter, Mary Berry, who was to come here with them, but due to a minor illness, couldn't make the trip. I hope she's watching online, because she was very important in getting this event put together. In addition, I'd like to thank the CLF Advance team and the associate director, Sean McKenzie, who also couldn't be here at the last minute due to a family illness, and also thank Alicia Carter, who is our events coordinator. First, I need to address a couple of housekeeping issues. As I said, we are live streaming Wendell's talk today on the university's Ustream channel, and we'll post a recording of this on the CLF website. We'll have a short question and answer session after Wendell's lecture, and since we are live streaming and recording, please wait for a microphone and keep your questions brief, because we have a large audience today. The hashtag CLF event has been set up to tweet about today's events and to text questions and comments for Wendell, and we'll try to get those asked from the audience. After the talk, CLF is hosting a reception downstairs in the gallery, and since we have a larger than normal crowd on hand today, I would ask that you be courteous and patient during the reception in the move to the reception area. It's my great honor and pleasure today to introduce Wendell Berry as the 17th Dodge Lecturer. Wendell is a poet, essayist, novelist, environmental activist, cultural critic, and my favorite job title, a farmer. He has authored more than 25 books of poetry, 16 volumes of essays, and numerous novels and short story collections. He has received too many awards to enumerate here today, but I would like to mention three. He was awarded the National Humanities Medal by President Obama in 2010. He was the 41st Jefferson Lecturer in the Humanities in 2012. And he was named a fellow in the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2013 in recognition of his life's work. In 1977, I was a young newspaper reporter, but left journalism to work as a press secretary on a congressional campaign of a new candidate in my home state of South Dakota. Agriculture is an important part of the economies of the Great Plains, and everybody there understands that. They don't have to be convinced. So I knew agriculture would be important to the candidate. I asked the candidate if he could recommend any reading I could do to understand his philosophy, the candidate's philosophy of agriculture. He said, quote, "Read The Unsettling of America by Wendell Berry," unquote. That was my first introduction to Wendell's agricultural writings, although I was aware of him because he eloquently had spoken out against the Vietnam War, both as folly and as a moral issue. By the way, Wendell, that candidate was Tom Daschle, who ended up being the U.S. Senate majority leader, finally. When asked by students what I would recommend they read to understand the problems we face in the areas of agriculture, health, and the environment, I always suggest The Unsettling of America, as was suggested to me. Selfishly, I recommend the Pew Commission on Industrial Farm Animal Production's final report, which I had a hand in. But I also suggest they read, at a minimum, Wendell's essay titled Solving for Pattern. In the beginning of that essay, he writes, quote, "Our dilemma in agriculture now is that the industrial methods that have so spectacularly solved some of the problems of food production have been accompanied by side effects so damaging as to threaten the survival of farming. Perhaps the best clue to the nature and gravity of this dilemma is that it is not limited to agriculture. My immediate concern here is with the irony of agricultural methods that destroy first the health of the soil and finally the health of human communities. But I could just as easily be talking about sanitation systems that pollute, school systems that graduate illiterate students, or medical cures that cause disease, or nuclear armaments that explode in the midst of the people they are meant to protect. This is a kind of surprise that is characteristic of our time. The cure provides incurable security results in the evacuation of a neighborhood or town. It's only when it is understood that our agricultural dilemma is characteristic not of our agriculture, but of our time, that we can begin to understand why these surprises happen, and then to work out standards of judgment that may prevent them." Please join me in welcoming Wendell Berry and his to read his essay, The Thought of Limits in a Prodigal Age.
Thanks as usual. Well, I think it, Dodge, and the staff of this program, that for an experience that's been altogether a pleasure. My talk is centered upon the thought that a proper economy would not exploit, siphon away, and finally destroy the life of the land and the people. A proper economy instead would recognize, value, cultivate, and conserve in any given place everything in it that is good and worth conserving. To make the economies of the land and of land use something like sustainable, we would have to begin with attention to the difference between the industrial economy of inert materials and monetary abstractions and an authentic land economy that must include the kindly husbanding of living creatures. This is the critical issue. If farming is no more than an industry to be unendingly transformed by technologies, as is happening, then farmers can be replaced by engineers, and engineers finally by robots, in the progress toward our evident goal of human uselessness. If, on the contrary, because of the uniqueness and fragility of each one of the world's myriad of small places, the land economies must involve a creaturely affection and care, then we must look back 3 or 4 generations and think again. From its beginning, industrialism has depended on its own and on most people's willingness to ignore everything that does not serve the cheapest possible production of merchandise and therefore the highest possible profit. And so, to look back and think again, we must acknowledge real needs that have continued through the years to be real, though unacknowledged. The need to see and respect the inescapable dependence, even of our present economy, as of our lives, upon nature and the natural world, and upon the need, just as important, to see and respect our inescapable dependence upon the economies of farming, ranching, forestry, fishing, and mining, by which the goods of nature are made serviceable to human good. To think well of such enterprises and of the possibility of combining them in a diverse and coherent local economy is to think of the need for sustaining all of the necessary occupations. Because a local, a placed economy would be built in sequence from the ground up, from primary production to manufacturing to marketing, a variety of occupations would be necessary. Because all would be necessary, all would be equally necessary. Because of the need to keep them all adequately staffed, it would be ruinous to prefer one above another by price, custom, or social prejudice. There must be a sustained economic parity among them. In such an economic structure, the land-using occupations are primary. Until the farmers, ranchers, foresters, and miners have done their work, nothing else that we count as economic can happen. And unless the land users do their work well, which is to say, without depleting the fertility of the earth's surface, nothing we count as economic can happen for very long. The land-using occupations, then, are of primary importance, but they're also the most vulnerable. We must notice to begin with that almost nobody in the supposedly higher occupational and social strata has ever recognized the estimable care, intelligence, knowledge, and artistry required to use the land without degrading or destroying it. Farmers may be the last minority that even liberals freely stereotype and insult. If farmers live and work in an economic squeeze between inflated purchases and depressed sales, if they're priced out of the land market, it is assumed that they deserve no better. The problem we must deal with here is that the primary producers in agriculture and forestry do not work well inevitably. On the contrary, in our present economy, there are constraints and even incentives that favor bad work, the result of which is waste of fertility and of the land itself. Good work in the use of the land is work that goes beyond production to maintenance. Production must not reduce productivity. Every mine eventually will be exhausted, but a farm, a ranch, or a forest where the laws of nature are obeyed in use. As given sufficient care and skill, we know they can be, will remain fertile and productive as long as nature lasts. Good work also is informed by traditional, locally adapted ways that must be passed down, taught, and learned generation after generation. The standard of such work as the lineages of good farmers and of agrarian scientists have demonstrated cannot be accomplished only by the market. The standard must be partly economic, for people have to live, but it must also be ecological in order to sustain the possibility of life. And if it is to be ecological, it must also be cultural. The economies of agriculture and forestry are vulnerable also because they're exceptional in this way to the industrial economy. Owners and workers in the land economy who grow their own food will not likely be starved into mistreating their land, but they can be taxed and priced into mistreating it. And so the parity of necessary occupations must be supported by parity of income. Parity in this sense is not a new thought. The Agricultural Adjustment Act defines parity as that gross income from agriculture, which will provide the farm operator and his family with a standard of living equivalent to those afforded persons dependent upon other gainful occupation. Perhaps the idea of parity does not need much explanation or defense if, as now and always, a sufficient staff of land users is necessary to the health of the land and therefore to the lives of all of us, then they should be afforded a decent livelihood. And this, the so-called free market, cannot provide except by accident. The concept of parity, as fair-minded and as necessary as it is, addresses one of the problems of farming and farmers in the industrial economy. Another such problem, more fundamental and more in need of understanding, is that of overproduction. Other gainful employment in the cities escapes this problem because the large industrial corporations have not characteristically overproduced. Surplus production is a risk native to commercial agriculture. This is because farmers individually and collectively do not know and cannot learn ahead of time the extent either of public need or of market demand. Given the right weather and the progressive application of technologies, their failure to control production, even in their own interest, is almost certain. Either because the market is good and they are encouraged, or because the market is bad and they are desperate, farmers tend to produce as much as they can. In the absence of imposed limits, overproduction will fairly predictably occur in agriculture as long as farmers and the land remain productive. It has only to be allowed by political indifference prescribed by evangels of the free market. For the corporate purchasers, the low price attendant upon overproduction is the greatest benefit, As for farmers, it is the singular cruelty of the current agricultural economy. Farm subsidies without production controls further encourage overproduction. In times of high costs and low prices, such subsidies are paid ultimately and quickly to the corporations. The traditional home economies of subsistence, while they lasted, gave farmers some hope of surviving their hard times. This was true, especially when the chief energy source was the sun and the dependence on purchased supplies was only minimal. As farming became less and less subsistent and more commercial, it was exposed ever more nakedly to the vagaries and the predation of an economy fundamentally alien to it. When farming is large in scale, is highly specialized, and all supplies are purchased, the farmer's exposure to the economy, as we call it, is total. When agricultural production is not controlled by a marketing cooperative, such as the tobacco program once was in my part of the country, the market becomes, from the standpoint of the farmers, a sort of limitless commons, of which the inevitable tragedy is inherent in its limitlessness. In the absence of any imposed limit that they collectively agree to and abide by, all producers may have as large a share of the market as they want or can take. Only in this sense is the market, to them, free. To limit production as a way of assuring an equitable return to producers is assuredly an abridgment of freedom. But freedom for what? For producers, it is the freedom to produce themselves into bankruptcy, to fail, that is, by succeeding. For the purchaser, it is the freedom to destroy the producers as a normal and acceptable expense. The only solution to the tragedy of the limitless market is for the producers to divide their side, the selling side of the market, into limited fair shares for all by limiting production, which is exactly what the tobacco program accomplished in my region. By preventing the farmers' overuse of the market, it prevented as well the overuse of the land. Another element of the agricultural tragedy of the market is political. And how was this by now entirely dominant political position on the agricultural free market defined? In the middle of the 20th century, think tanks containing corporate and academic experts laid down the decree that there were too many farmers. They decreed further that the excess should be removed as rapidly as possible, and that the instrument of this removal would be the free market, all price supports and production controls being eliminated. The assumption evidently was that the removed farmers would be replaced by industrial technologies recommended by the land-grant universities and supplied by the corporations. This would institute an evolutionary process that would unerringly eliminate the least efficient producers. Only the fittest would survive. In short, by granting a limitless permission and scope to the free market and technological progress, which is assumed to work invariably for the best, politicians, by doing merely nothing, could rid themselves of any concern for farmers or farmland. Against this heartless determinism it is useful to remember that it was the aim of the program for Burley Tobacco to include and help every farmer, even the smallest, who wanted to grow the crop. The difference was in the minds of the people whose work during four decades at last, shaped an effective program. Those people, unlike the experts of the mid-century think tanks, were thoughtful of the needs of farming and farmers, as opposed to the needs of the corporate free market, known as the economy. The doctrine of too many farmers has never been revoked. No limit to the attrition has been proposed. As evidence of the persistence of the doctrine of too many farmers, here is a passage from a letter of October 3rd of this year from John Logan Brent, Judge Executive of Henry County, Kentucky. Here's what he says. I have taken a couple of afternoons to work on the accounting for farming cattle under the current terms. Enclosed, you will find that product based upon a real example, which is our 100-acre farm and its approximately 25-cow herd. The good news is that for a young man wishing to earn a middle to slightly below middle class annual salary of $45,000 farming cattle full time, he has only to have $3,281,000 in capital to get started. If he can find 780 acres to rent, he only has to have $551,000 for used cows and equipment. I say this is the good news because the reality is that this was based on a weaned calf price of $850 from June of this year. According to today's sales reports, that same calf is now $650 at best, and you know the decline is in progress. The related problems of low prices and overproduction of a single but significant crop were solved for about 60 years in my part of the country in the only way they could be solved, by a combination of price supports and production controls. This was the purpose and the work of the tobacco program as a part of Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal. I need now to look closely at the Burley Tobacco Growers Cooperative Association, which was our version of the tobacco program, not as the brightest public occurrence in the history of my home countryside, but in terms of the suitability of its economic strategy to farming everywhere. Here I must acknowledge that this organization, and more than the organization, its economic principles, have had the allegiance and the service of members of my family, my father, my brother, my children, for 90 or so years. Under this program, support prices for the various grades of tobacco were set according to a formula for assuring a fair return on the cost of production. Production was controlled by allotting to each farm, according to its history of production, at first an acreage and later a poundage that would be eligible for price supports under the program. The combined sum of the allotments for each year was determined by the supply of tobacco worldwide that was available for manufacture. To buy a protected crop or a portion thereof, a purchaser had to bid a penny a pound above the support price. The government's assistance to the program consisted of a loan made annually against the crop, which permitted the program to purchase, store, and resell the portion of any year's crop that did not earn the extra money or the extra penny a pound, which, thanks to the loan, would be purchased by the association and the grower paid at the warehouse. The cost to the government was only administrative until, in response to protests, this cost was charged to the farmers, and the program then operated on the basis of no net cost. The point most needing to be made is that parity of pricing under the tobacco program was in no sense a subsidy. It did not involve a grant of money, a government giveaway, or a public charity. The concept of parity was used by intention to prevent government subsidization. Its purpose was to achieve fair prices, fairly determined, and with minimal help from the government. My father defended parity as an appropriate incentive. It accords with our way of life, he said, and it gives real and tangible meaning to the philosophy of equal opportunity. He thought of direct subsidy payments as virtually opposite to parity and an abominable form of regimentation. During the six decades of its life, the Burley Tobacco Growers Cooperative Association helped to keep farm families on their farms and gainfully employed in Kentucky, Missouri, Indiana, Ohio, and West Virginia. One measure of its success was the decrease of farm tenancy among the growers from 33% in 1940 to 9% in 1970. Some of the population of tenant farmers undoubtedly died, and some left farming during those years. But most of them ceased to be tenant farmers by becoming owners of farms. This was a defining event in the lives of a considerable number of worthy people whom I knew. The members of the association overwhelmingly renewed their support in referendum after referendum. The Burley Association was thus truly a commons and a common good, based not only upon correct political and economic principles, but also upon the common history and culture, and thus upon the understanding consent of its sharers. So complete was the understanding of the members that in 1955, because of an oversupply of tobacco in storage, they voted for a 25% reduction of their allotments. On April 8, 2016, my neighbor Thomas Grissom, by far the best historian of the association, wrote in a personal letter to me, "After years of research, I have concluded that the most distinctive characteristic of the Kentucky Burley Tobacco Program is its design and application of an industrial agriculture commodity program to the cultivation and production of an agrarian crop indigenous to an agrarian community or society." I think that Tom's perception is exactly right, and that he found the right and necessary terms to describe it. Burley Tobacco, despite the dire health problems that it was found to cause and the consequent disfavor, was very much an agrarian crop. It was characteristically and mainly the product of small family farms, produced mainly by family labor and exchanges of work among neighbors. It was for a long time the staple crop in a highly diversified way of farming on landscapes that typically required considerate and affectionate care. As long as the market paid highly for high quality, the production of burley tobacco demanded, and from its many highly competent producers, it received both conscientious land husbandry and a fine artistry. Industrialism and agrarianism are almost exactly opposite and opposed. Industrialism regards mechanical or technical functions as ideal. It rates its accomplishments by quantitative measures. Though it values the prestige of public charity, it is motivated necessarily by the antisocial traits that assure success in competition. Agrarianism, by contrast, arises from the primal wish for a homeland or home place, the wish, in the terms of our tradition, for the freedom and independence that come with dependence on a place, a parcel of land, however small, that one owns and is owned by, or has at least the use of. Agrarianism grants its highest practical value to the good husbandry of the land. It is motivated to an extent effective and significant by neighborliness, family loyalty, and devotion to the coherence and longevity of communities. As long as it has a sufficiency of natural resources and remains free of any imposed restraint, an industrial economy, by its inevitable failure to restrain itself, will dominate and destroy an agrarian economy, no matter that the agrarian economy is indispensable for a continuing supply of resources. This defines precisely the need for the design and application of an industrial agricultural commodity program to the cultivation and production of an agrarian crop indigenous to an agrarian society. For a while, the Burley Tobacco Growers Cooperative Association, never mind the deserved infamy of tobacco, did preserve a sort of balance between the interests of industrialism and agrarianism, which prevented their inherent difference and opposition from becoming absolute, and thus absolutely destructive of the agrarian society. This balance was fair enough to the industry, and it permitted the growers to prosper. The program worked, in fact, to the best interest of both economies. That doing nothing for farmers and almost nothing for farmland has been official government policy for the past six decades, there is no reason to doubt. In 1995, for example, President Clinton spoke to an audience of farmers and farm leaders in Billings, Montana. He acknowledged that the farm population by then was dramatically lower than it was a generation ago, that's his language. But he said that was inevitable because of the increasing productivity of agriculture. Nevertheless, he wanted to save the family farm, which he held to be alive and well in Montana. He believed we had bottomed out in the shrinking of the farm sector. He said he wanted to help young farmers. He spoke of the need to make agriculture competitive with people around the world, and so on. He could not have meant what he said, because he was speaking without benefit of thought. And why should he have thought when he was not expected to do so? He was speaking 40 or 50 years after politicians and their consulting experts had abandoned any effort to think about agriculture. Inevitable is a word much favored by people in positions of authority who do not wish to think about problems. When and why did Mr. Clinton in 1995 think that the inevitable shrinking of the farm sector had ceased? In fact, the farm sector had not bottomed out in 1995, and there's no good reason to think that it has bottomed out at less than 1% of the population in 2016. Mr. Clinton was talking nonsense in Billings in 1995 because he had not in himself and could not have had from any of his advisors the means to think about what he thought he was talking about. The means of actual thought about the use and care of the land had been intentionally discounted and forgotten by people such as themselves. But the people who decided in the middle of the 20th century that there were too many farmers had, in fact, no agricultural knowledge or competence upon which to base such a judgment. They and their successors certainly had not the competence to assume any responsibility for or in any way to mitigate the totalitarian displacement of about 20 million farmers. Farming is one of the major enactments of the connection between the human economy and the natural world. In the industrial age, farming also enacts the connection, far more complicated and perilous than industrialists admit, between industrial technologies and living creatures. Some science certainly needs to be involved, also more and better accounting. But good farming is first and last an art, a way of doing and making that involves human histories, cultures, minds, hearts, and souls. It is not the application by dullards of methods and technologies under the direction of a corporate academic intelligentsia. If we should want to revive or begin in a public way the actual thinking about agriculture, farming itself, farming as such, that has actually taken place in some cultures, that is still taking place in some small organizations and on some farms, what would we have to do? We would have to begin, I think, by giving the most careful attention to issues of carrying capacity, scale, and form. To issues of production, of course, but also, and just as necessarily, to issues of maintenance or conservation. The indispensable issue of conservation would apply not just to the farm's agricultural resources, but also to the ecosystem that includes the farm and to the waterways that drain it. It is immediately obvious that this effort of thinking has to confront everywhere the limits, both of nature and of human nature, limits imposed by the ecosphere and ecosystems, limits of human intelligence, human cultures, and the capacities of human persons. Such thought is authenticated by its compatibility with limits, its willingness to accept limits and to limit itself. This will not be easy in a time overridden by fantasies of limitlessness, such as that of limitless economic growth. A market limitlessly usable by sellers and limitlessly exploitable by buyers is merely normal in such a time. And limitlessness is the common denominator of both of the dominant political sides, both of which tend to refer to limitlessness as freedom. We have the liberal freedom of unrestrained personal behavior and the conservative freedom of unrestrained economic behavior. These two freedoms are more alike, more allied, and more collaborative than either side acknowledges. Opposition to the industrial economy's ravaging of the landscapes of farming and forestry now comes from a small and scattered alliance of agrarians, not from liberals or conservatives. Whatever the justification, both the personal and the corporate programs are now popularly authorized to overrule any communal or social responsibility. Conservatives and liberals disagree passionately about climate change, for example, while mutually assenting to the waste and pollution that are the causes of climate change. And neither the conservatives who esteem the fossil fuels nor the liberals who deplore them have advocated rationing their use, either to make them last or to reduce their harm. For those people, the old ideals of enough and plenty have been overruled by the ideals of all you want and all you can get. They cannot imagine that for farmers, a limitless market share, like a limitless appetite, can lead only to the related diseases of too much and too little. Science, apart from moral limits in scientists, seems to be limitless, for it has produced nuclear and chemical abominations that humans, with their limited intelligence, can neither limit nor safely live with. Anything goes and stop at nothing are the moral principles that some scientists have borrowed, apparently, from the greediest of conservatives and the most libertine of liberals. The faith that limitless technological progress will finally solve the problems of limitless contamination is at best indefinitely dependent upon the future. The good care of land and people, on the contrary, depends primarily upon arts, ways of making and doing. One cannot be, above all, a good neighbor without such ways. And the arts, all of them, are limited. Apart from limits, they cannot exist. The making of any good work of art depends first upon limits of purpose and attention, and then upon limits specific to the kind of art and its means. And here we return to the very formidable paradox. In order to achieve the sort of limitlessness of the living world that we have begun to call sustainability, strict limits must be observed. Enduring structures of household and family life, or the life of a community, or the life of a country, cannot be formed except within limits. Within limits, we can think of rightness of scale. When the scale is right, we can imagine completeness of form. The first limit to be encountered in making a farm or a regional or national economy is carrying capacity. How much can we ask of this land, this field, or this pasture, or this woodland without diminishing the land's response? And then we come to other limits, each one addressing directly our imagination, sympathy, affection, forbearance, knowledge, and skill. And now I must call to mind Aldo Leopold, who, unlike most conservationists since John Muir, thought beyond wilderness conservation to conservation of the country's economic landscapes of farming and forestry. His conception of humanity's relation to the natural world was eminently practical. He knew that land destruction is easy, for it requires only ignorance and violence. But to restore the land and to conserve it require humanity in its highest, completest sense. The Leopold family renewed the fertility and health of their farmed-out Sand County farm by their work, their pleasure, and their great love for their place and for one another. Aldo Leopold thought carefully about farming and forestry because he knew that far more land would be put to those uses than ever could be safeguarded in wilderness preserves. In an essay of 1945, The Outlook for Farm Wildlife, he laid side by side two opposing philosophies of farm life. That's his language, and this is two. One, the farm is a food factory, and the criterion of its success is saleable products. Two, the farm is a place to live. The criterion of success is a harmonious balance between plants, animals, and people, between the domestic and the wild, between utility and beauty. This is a statement about form. Contrasting a form that is too simple and too exclusive with a form that may be complex enough to accommodate the interest of what is actually involved. Under the rule of the first form, Leopold wrote, the trend of the landscape is toward monotype. This form can be adequately described as the straightest, shortest line between input and income. All else is left out or denied. The second form is described as a harmonious balance among a diversity of interests that, in the absence of such a form, might be randomly congenial or merely different or opposed. On a farm made whole by the high artistry of farming, each part is both limited and enabled by the others. This harmonious balance, I should not need to say, cannot be prefabricated. It can be realized only uniquely within the boundary of any given farm, according to the natures and demands of its indwelling plants and animals, and according to the abilities, needs, and wishes of its resident human family. Wherever this is fully accomplished, it is a grand masterpiece to behold. Light is green.
That means we're ready to go. So we have a little bit of time for some questions from the audience. I ask that you move to a microphone and keep your questions brief. So it looks like we have one over here.
Yes, thank you. A quick thing before that, wanted to mention that for those who don't know, Johns Hopkins himself grew up on a tobacco farm not far from here until his Quaker father manumitted slaves around 1805. The question is the following. In 1950, there were about 2.5 billion people on the planet, and now we're close to triple that at 7.4. Some argue that if we had sustainable agriculture, for example, organic farming, we could only feed 4 or 5 billion on the planet. So we need industrial agriculture to feed our 7 billion. Could you address this dilemma?
Yes, I will address that by pointing out that nobody's ever done the numbers on that. So far as I've seen that repeated over and over again without reference to any expert who's ever doped it out. It's just a bad excuse that can be given in a hurry for a bad program of farming that destroys the land in order to make it productive. And you can't feed any number of billions of people by that kind of work.
So maybe we need CLF to fund some research on that. Thank you.
Questions? Can you move to a microphone, please? Could you speak more clearly into the microphone,
we
please?
We seem to have replaced tobacco with corn. Hard put to know which is worse, and it's spreading internationally. What do you think of crop selection?
So we've replaced tobacco with corn.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, what should be the crop?
Yes, well, during the anti-smoking anxiety, it was frequently suggested that you could replace tobacco with corn. There are a number of things wrong with that. One was that corn is cheaper than tobacco, especially if it's grown under the rule of all you can grow. Farmers are, there's going to be a big attrition of corn and bean farmers this year because of that. If corn is cheaper per acre than tobacco, and you put more acres into cultivation in a broken, vulnerable, fragile country like mine, you destroy a lot of land. Why put a state like Kentucky that goes this way into competition with the prairie states that go this way? So there was really nothing to that. Some ex-tobacco farmers are now growing corn and beans in Kentucky, and I see it every day. And I will tell you, it is an abomination.
So here.
Hello, Mr. Berry. I'm from McLean County, Kentucky. And I've been very inspired by your work and Harry Cottle and Robert Penn Warren. And after reading your latest book, Our Only World, I was left with the impression that there's a deeply, very deeply held conception or belief in progress in this society. And I was wondering if you thought that the American conception of progress, which is a very, very deeply held belief, if you think that it's a backwards conception of progress.
The last part I didn't.
The conception of progress a backwards conception?
A backwards conception. Well, we've got to have standards. And the prevailing standard now for progress is how frequently new products are put on the market and how much money is made from them. That leaves a good deal out. It leaves out the issue of the health of the land and the health of the people. We have a society now of people who've been trained as consumers. it's rather disheartening to see. You put a new electronic product out like this, and the whole population virtually stands on its hind legs like a bunch of trained dogs and begins to snap at it. There's a different way to think about things. And the question is, what's this doing to our people? What's this doing to our communities? The only people in the United States who routinely ask that question about progress, is the Amish. And the Amish always, when they're confronted with an innovation and the question of whether they should adopt it or not, always ask, what will this do to our community? It's a wonderfully radical question. After that radical writing that we call the Gospels, it works for the Amish. It would for the rest of us.
Next question over here.
I'm concerned about the present administration, especially with the diminishing role of the EPA. Do you have any thoughts about that, and with especially Scott Pruitt being nominated?
Concerned about the role of the EPA under the new administration.
In the present administration, she said, but that's, she's talking about the new one.
The new
yes,
one,
yes,
yeah.
I'm sorry, the new one.
Yeah.
Well, this calls for a very long answer, but part of the upset that brought forth this coming in administration was that people are encountering bureaucracy every which way, everywhere, and it has, in lots of ways, become a bit too much. For instance, if you had a little sawmill at home in the country, OSHA came around and told you you had to have a toilet, plumbing, which would put the sawmill out of business, you see, and it did. If you had a little slaughterhouse, some other outfit would come in and tell you you had to have stainless steel this and stainless steel that, plus a toilet especially for the inspector. And of course that put the country slaughterhouses out of business. But then the rule that put those people out of business would not apply, as Eric Schlosser's book, Fast Food Nation, showed. You apply the rule to get rid of the competition for the big corporations. That collects, and it begins to have a force, like a fermenting puddle. And then they began to be against all regulation. And to have a huge populace of people against all regulation lines them up, you see, with their exploiters, namely the corporations. So this is a very confused situation that we're in. And it seems to me that what we have to watch out for is the inevitable tendency on both sides to oversimplify it. We use the bad politicians in Kentucky, and we run in that direction on our politicians, is to exploit the Environmental Protection Agency and the so-called war against coal. And how much of that can be undone is an interesting question. It's very complicated. But people like our pride and joy, Mitch McConnell, talk about the war against coal as if he didn't know any more than that. He knows quite a bit more than that, I can tell you that much.
Question over here.
Hi. We've been talking, you talk a lot about farming, traditional farming on soil. And its importance and connection to us as people, and it also just has implications for our own communities and with each other. Do you have any ideas or thoughts on hydroponics and the potential effects of that? Because it seems like that's relatively new technology, I guess.
Just the effects of
hydroponics.
Yeah.
It's a weird question, sorry.
No, I don't have any knowledge really much about hydroponics. I've seen it in action. In certain situations, it seems to me pretty good. There's a restaurant in Lexington, Kentucky, that runs all its garbage into fish tanks. And then the water from the fish tanks, it's fertilized in by the decomposition of the garbage and the fish fertilizer goes to raise the salad greens for the restaurant. That's just fine, it seems to me. As a way of producing food on a large scale, I'm against it, and it may just be prejudice. But I like to see things growing outdoors. I'm prejudiced in favor of solar power. I'm prejudiced in favor of solar collectors in the form of animals. I like that, and I'm always working to validate my prejudice, of course.
I think we have a question from online over here.
All right.
Yes, we received a number of questions on Twitter. Here are just the first two that I received. The first is, the technology required to care for our bodies requires some industrialization. How does that square with your vision? And the second question from another person is, please.
Wait a minute, let's deal with the first one.
Okay.
Let's just stay right there.
Yeah, the technology is required to care for our bodies. So how does that square with
technologies that are?
Yeah, the argument that technology is and agriculture does not fit.
Is not.
Yeah, would you restate it?
I think it has to do with technology and advances in healthcare, and how that may square with your concept of industrialization.
The advances in technology and healthcare, and how does that square with your thoughts about industrialization?
Okay. I'm sorry that I'm having trouble hearing all of you. I don't know why it is, but I'm not hearing even as well as I usually do. Valid criticism has to go case by case. Mm-hmm. And there isn't probably anybody here who hasn't benefited in some way from modern medical technology. And probably a good many people here who have benefited have been dismayed by the possibility that it can be heartlessly used. And so issues of scale and questions about the meaning of care arise. And those have to be dealt with point by point. Compassionate nurses and doctors can use some of these technological advances very well. But nobody on that account wants to be nursed or doctored by a robot because there's something between us humans. We like to touch each other. We like to be touched in the heart as well as on the shoulder or elsewhere. And we don't want to remove that. So the Amish, in their question about technology, what does this mean to our community, are in effect considering what is meant by substitution of things or machines or chemicals for people. And they have had the gumption and the good heart to say, I won't replace my neighbor with a piece of machinery. I won't replace my children with a piece of machinery. Okay, next.
Yeah, next question. And I'm afraid this will have to be the last question.
Thank you. The last question is, please comment on the plight of honeybees.
Please comment on the plight of honeybees.
Oh, well, the plight of honeybees.
Plight.
I do notice that. I always loved to stand in a patch of white clover in bloom and see the bees. And now when I walk into a patch of blooming white clover, I look around and I don't see many bees. I see a few. I'm always glad to see them. And then we have to understand that we as living creatures are cousins to the bees. And so we can't find that they're in a plight without finally understanding that their plight is our plight. I'm in correspondence. I know beekeepers, and they're all worried. So you go into a patch of wildflowers or a patch of flowers anywhere, and you look around, and you're looking for the pollinators because they're the connection makers. They're connecting, among other things, the past and the future. So let the honeybee be our emblem of the end of this conversation.